بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وبه نستعين.
يا ألف مليون تكاثر عدهم إن الصلاة بنا يتبختر فالحرب دائرة على الإسلام يا قومي فهل منكم أبي يتر. يا ألف مليون
إنكم يومئذ كثير ولكنكم غثاء كغثاء السجن. المسنجر صلى الله عليه وسلم سأل إنكم يومئذ كثير ولكنكم غثاء كغثاء السجن. Your numbers at that time will be a lot. You'll be more than them. But you will be like the scum that's carried down by the streams and currents. ولكنكم غثاء كغثاء السجن. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take fear of you from the breast of your enemy. And he will put wahan in your hearts. Someone asked the Prophet of Allah, what's wahan? He said, love of this world and dislike of death. حب الدنيا وكراهية الموت. The numbers will be a lot. But there's wahan in the hearts.
يا أيها الذين آمنوا هل أدلكم على تجارة تنجيكم من عذاب أليم تؤمنون بالله ورسوله وتجاهدون في سبيل الله بأموالكم وأنفسكم ذلكم خير لكم إن كنتم تعلمون يغفر لكم ذنوبكم ويدخلكم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار ومساكن طيبة في جنات عدن ذلك الفوز العظيم وأخرى تحبونها نصر من الله وفتح قريب وبشر المؤمنين
أذن للذين يقاتلون بأن وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى نَصْرِهِمْ لَقَدِيرٌ
الَّذِينَ أُخْرِجُوا مِنْ دِيَارِهِمْ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍّ إِلَّا أَنْ يَقُولُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهُ وَلَوْلَا دَفْعُ اللَّهِ النَّاسَ بَعْضَهُمْ لهدمت صوامع وبيع وصلوات ومساجد يذكر فيها اسم الله كثيرا ولينصرن الله من ينصره إن الله لقوي عزيز
وما لكم لا تقاتلون في سبيل الله والمستضعفين من الرجال والنساء والولدان الذين يقولون ربنا أخرجنا من هذه القرية الظالم أهلها واجعل لنا من لدنك وليا واجعل لنا من لدنك نصيرا الذين آمنوا يقاتلون في سبيل الله والذين كفروا يقاتلون في سبيل الطاغوت فقاتلوا أولياء الشيطان إن كيد الشيطان كان ضعيفا.
The entire ummah looks forward for fasting. They love fasting Ramadan. One of the biggest sha'air of Islam that Muslims look forward for. Preparation and happiness and the positive change in the mood. It becomes very apparent anywhere you go. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Kutiba alaykum al-siyam. They look forward for it because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Kutiba alaykum al-siyam. Fasting is ordained on you. The same one who said fasting is ordained on you said, Kutiba alaykum al-qital. Jihad. Jihad is ordained upon you. You can't say, Wallah, I love fasting. It's good. So I'm going to take it. And I'm going to believe in it. And I'm going to practice it. But qital and jihad, no, I don't believe in that. أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْضِ. It's about time we understand the proper meaning in path to victory. In Sahih Muslim, a man asked the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what do you think if someone comes to take my property? The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, don't give it to him. Don't surrender it. Don't give in. He said, what if he fights me? The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, then fight him. أَرَأَيْتَ إِن قَاتَلَنِي قَالَ قَاتِلْهُ قَالَ أَرَأَيْتَ إِن قَتَلَنِي قَالَ فَأَنْتَ شَهِيدٌ. It's about time the ummah starts thinking like it should. We're the best ummah ever raised for mankind. We should be proud of it. And we need to start thinking and acting like it. We can't keep crying over massacres that happen to Muslims. And then when the dust somewhat settles, we forget all about it until the next active genocide or massacre takes place again and again and again. I strongly advocated and showed proof for the boycotts. And I still do. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward those who call for it. But they're not the solution. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward everyone who sincerely raised awareness for what's going on in Palestine and elsewhere. And those who refuted the media lies. Some of our students were refuting them day and night. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward them. It's no doubt a great effort, but it's not the solution. The solution is disliked to many. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it's disliked. كتب عليكم القتال وهو كره لكم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قل إن كان آباؤكم وأبناؤكم وإخوانكم وأزواجكم وعشيرتكم وأموال اقترفتموها وتجارة تخشون كسادها ومساكن ترضونها أحب إليكم من الله ورسوله وجهاد في سبيله فتربصوا حتى يأتي الله بأمره والله لا يهدي القوم الفاسقين. If your fathers and your sons, قل إن كان آباءكم, if your fathers and your sons and your brothers and your spouses or wives, وعشيرتكم وأموال اقترفتموها, if your tribe and the wealth that you've been saving, وتجارة تخشون كسادها وَمَسَاكِنُ تَرْضَوْنَ, and the commerce and business that you have that you fear you will lose or that it will decline, and the dwellings that you enjoy, if that or anything similar to that, your college degree, your career, your comfort, your luxury, if any of that is more beloved to you than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَجِهَادٍ فِي سَبِيلِهِ, in jihad, if it's more beloved to you than jihad, فَتَرَبَّصُوا حَتَّى يَأْتِيَ اللَّهُ بِأَمْرِهِ, wait for Allah's torment. أَحَبَّ إِلَيْكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, that any of that which is mentioned in the verse, if it's more beloved to you than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the messenger, some said it means hijrah. So those in the West, especially in the US, who are able to leave, they shouldn't be here. If you're not able to leave for some reason, have the sincere determination and intention to leave at the first chance that you can. If that which is mentioned in the verse is more beloved to you than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger, وَجِهَادٍ فِي سَبِيلِهِ, what'll happen? Await Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's torment. فَتَرَبَّصُوا حَتَّى يَأْتِيَ اللَّهُ بِأَمْرِهِ. Torment. And that torment is in dunya and akhirah. In Sunan Abu Dawood, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, in meaning, when you recline to the dunya and give up jihad, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make disgrace prevail over you. Disgrace will prevail and disgrace will remain until you return to your original religion. وَتَرَكْتُمُ الْجِهَادَ صَلَّتَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ ذُلًّا لَا يَنْزِعُهُ حَتَّى تَرْجِعُوا إِلَى دِينِكُمْ. When you leave jihad, disgrace will dominate. Jihad under the pure banner of Tawheed, to raise the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala supreme, which entails protecting Muslim lives, their honor, and their lands. Ibn Hajar rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned among the major sins is leaving jihad. And he gave three examples, he said, or scenarios. He said, it's like when jihad becomes obligatory. How so? He said, like when invaders invade Muslim lands. Or he said, it's when a Muslim captive is being taken and Muslims are able to go and free him. Or he said, when people leave jihad entirely. If you can't raise your child telling him you want him to grow up to be a mujahid and a shaheed, then you're the root of the problem. We talk about the heroism of Khalid ibn al-Walid and Abu Ubaida radiallahu anhum, and the victory of Badr and Al-Ahzab. Some shed tears at the stories of Umayr ibn al-Humam and Anas ibn al-Nadr and other Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in. Anas radiallahu anhum, the man who felt bad that he missed the first battle. He missed Badr. In Uhud he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see what I will do. Wallahi la in arani Allahu mashhadan ma'a Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam la yarayanna Allahu ma asna'. He advanced towards Uhud, given an oath that he smells the smell of Jannah. He vigorously fought until he was found after the battle dead with 80 wounds. No one could recognize him but his sister from his fingertips. When the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before the battle of Badr said, get up to a Jannah that's wider than the heavens and the earth, Umayr ibn al-Humam said, if I live to eat these dates, it'll be too long of a life. Radiallahu anhum ajma'in. You see, those who cry when they hear or remember these stories, in a lot of them, their tears are crocodile tears. Why? Why would I say that? Because when someone today talks that talk and walks that walk, they'll refer to him as a radical and an extremist. And they may even call the authorities to keep an eye on him. When the war in Afghanistan was blessed by America against the Soviets in the 80s and 90s, the fatwas supporting jihad were pouring in like rain. The khutab were inspiring people to go to jihad. The money was openly collected for jihad and mujahideen. You used to go to any airline, any Saudi Airlines branch, say, I'm going to Pakistan to go fight in Afghanistan. They say half the ticket is off. The ones who returned to visit their families were heroes because America blessed it. When it's not blessed by America, the fatwa is it's fitna. Stay away. They're khawarij to scare the ummah from them. The examples of their betrayal are many. Rape, in violation of women by the Aqsa and elsewhere, ongoing for the past 8 years. Men, women, children are taken as prisoners daily. Families and towns are evacuated. Farms are destroyed. For 80 years, families are evicted and their houses are constantly being leveled. Livelihood destroyed. For 80 years, they've been denied the basic necessities of life. That's been going on for 80 years nonstop. The Shar'i Fiqh term for defending oneself is called jihad al-daf'a, defensive jihad. The Jews of the Qibla, the Murji'a rejects, think the Ummah needs the permission of one of their tawaghit to defend themselves from occupiers. That's the principle they have. They made everything about their rulers. A genocide in Gaza won't trigger them, but a word about their leaders will. Leaders who brought the filthy tarfih, the entertainments and concerts into Bilad al-Haramain while the people of Gaza were being massacred. They replaced the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and beloyed the enemies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave permission for those transgressed and to defend themselves. They don't need the permission of any filthy ruler in the UAE or the filthy rulers in Bilad al-Haramain or any other ruler for that matter. أُذِنَ لِلَّذِينَ يُقَاتَلُونَ بِأَنَّهُمْ ظُلِمُوا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى نَصْرِهِمْ لَقَدِيرٌ. Allah gave permission to defend oneself. This verse is in the context of self-defense. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives permission, you don't need the permission of anyone else. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala said about this self-defense jihad, فَلَا يُشْتَرَطُ لَهُ شَرْطٌ. They falsely claimed to follow Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab when his grandson, Abdurrahman ibn Hassan, had the most firm, solid statements refuting this claim of theirs, just like Ibn Hazm and many other ulama. Some of the Jews of the Qibla began to join in with the liberals and allege such verses are specific to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that's because they lack the basic ABCs of tafsir. They want the Ummah to seek permission to defend themselves from leaders who are publicly indulging in normalization with the enemy himself. And that's what's over the table. What's been going on under the table is much worse. But don't forget, talk about the good our leaders do. They've expanded al-Masjid al-Nabawi. They've expanded al-Masjid al-Haram. They're putting Qur'ans and printing them. They're making Hajj easier. Little do they know that saving the precious life of one child in Palestine, or one child, or one woman, or man in Yemen, or in Iraq, or elsewhere, is incomparably more important than the expansion of the physical structure of the Haram all the way down to China. The Kaaba being destroyed, and the earth along with it is less significant before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the killing of a single child in Gaza. The killing of a believer is more grievous before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the extinction of the whole world. When Quraysh made the same arguments the Jews of the Qibla make today, we're providing for the pilgrims. We're giving them water. We're maintaining the haram. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rebuked them. أَجَعَلْتُمْ سِقَايَةَ الْحَاجِّ وَعِمَارَةَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ كَمَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَجَاهَدَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ لَا يَسْتَوُونَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. Don't you ever compare providing water to the pilgrims and managing the haram to those who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the last day and do jihad in the path of Allah wherever they are. wherever they may be. The recent events exposed how the Jews of the Qibla want people enslaved to their rulers. They want to take people from being slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to being submissive slaves to their tawaghit. Their idea of tawheed, when they say tawheed, is to take people from the shirk of the graves, which they keep repeating, and correctly so, because it can't be emphasized enough. But they want to take you out of that shirk into the shirk of the palaces. Islam came to honor mankind by being the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they come to submit mankind to tawaghit. The obedience to orders from Muslim rulers, is when they're Muslim and their commands are in obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu ati'u Allah wa ati'u ar-rasul wa ulil amri minkum. O you who believe, obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and obey the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and those who are in authority. Ati'u Allah, obey Allah. Wa ati'u ar-rasul, obey the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa ulil amri minkum. And those in authority. Ati'u was omitted when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said wa ulil amri minkum. The term ati'u was omitted from wa ulil amri minkum. Obedience to Muslim rulers is when they're obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The continuation of the verse stresses that. فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ. If you differ in a matter, refer to the rulers. If you differ in anything, refer to Allah and His Messenger if you believe in Allah and the Judgment Day.
Shuyukh today teach the ummah how to be surrenderous and how to develop a defeatist mentality, especially the liberals and the Jews of the Qibla. Isn't their most hated topic jihad? And their most hated people to them is the mujahideen? When they teach an Islam stripped of jihad, they're in reality teaching their audience how to lay down on their stomachs in surrenderous mode, waiting for the enemy to do to them as they please. When the Jews of the Qibla and Murji'a rejects say you need the permission of the traitor ruler, whether it's Abu Mazen or the traitors in UAE or in Bilad al-Haramain, when they say you need their permission to defend yourself, they're in reality teaching the ummah to be submissive, surrenderous slaves to the enemy. When the Maghul invaded Baghdad, it was estimated they killed 2 million Muslims. The few who survived the massacres died from plagues that were caused by hilltops of bodies. When they entered Baghdad, they continued killing for 40 days, nonstop, taking the Muslimat as slaves. The only reason they stopped the genocide was out of fear from the plagues of the decomposing bodies that were piled up and rotten. A soldier from the Tatar found 40 infants whose mothers were all killed, so he killed all the infants. Our ummah went through much worse than what we're going through today. Aside from the killing, they burnt Bayt al-Hikmah, one of the biggest historic libraries back then, and they destroyed other libraries, and they dumped the books into Nahar Dijla. They dumped the books into the Tigris River, to the point that the river changed colors. It turned black from the ink of the books. A soldier would cross from one side of the Tigris River onto the other side over the books. They made a bridge out of the books to cross from one side to the other. They turned the masajid into stables and barns for their horses. When you read about that era, you get astonished and your jaw drops. They wondered back then, would Islam ever make a comeback? Or is it the end of the world? Nearly four decades after they began invading Muslim lands. In 2 years after the big massacre in Baghdad, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends the ummah men to revive the dead hearts with izzah in jihad that lead the way to victory. And among them is Mahmud ibn Mamdud Saifuddin Qutuz. He tried to unite the ummah. The Muslims had a defeatist mentality with lack of optimism and lack of ambition and lack of yaqeen in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Muslims at that point had a defeatist mindset. Their mindset was set on accepting defeat and humility. It was normalized in their minds to start the flames of jihad to defend Islam and Muslims. He needed to inspire them with words and in action. He needed to prep them with izzah. And let me give you a few examples on how bad the defeatist mentality was. A man told Ibn al-Athir, I was walking with 17 of my friends, and a soldier from the Tatar approached us and said, tie each other. You guys have to tie each other. He said, my friends began to tie each other. 17 Muslims versus one soldier from the Tatar. The man told Ibn al-Athir, who documented it, I told my friends, we can kill this man and flee. He said, but they were too afraid. 17 Muslims tying each other, waiting to be killed by a single soldier from the Tatar. They're facing imminent death. Why not die fighting? Izzah, yaqeen, and optimism vanished from the hearts. Dhul was normalized in the hearts, and that's what we can't have today. Lack of optimism paralyzes the hearts and limbs. The limbs were paralyzed. That's why 17 couldn't take a soldier down. The man said to Ibn al-Athir, I told him, he wants to kill us. Let's at least try to kill him. He said, wallahi, not a single one of them had the courage to kill him. He said, I took a knife, I stabbed him and killed him, and we fled. And there's many stories like that. In the past, it was prolonged massacres and vicious enemies with lack of inspiration and optimism that resulted in a defeatist mentality. Today, the defeatist status is actually taught and aggressively promoted by those who claim to be Muslims. So which era is worse in this matter? And that's why Sheikh Nasir al-Fahd, Sheikh al-Allama al-Mujahid Nasir al-Fahd, Fakkallahu bil-Izzi Asra, said, I studied history from the time of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam until today. And I don't know of any era where the ulama were sellouts like they are today. Very factual, very true. Ibn al-Athir said a man would walk in an alley from the Tatar, a soldier, killing 100 Muslims. Not one would raise a finger to attack him or tackle him or fight him or resist him or oppose him. The psychological defeat crept into the hearts of the Muslims, and we want to cure that in the hearts of the Muslims today. Pessimism and lack of yaqeen crippled them. They were psychologically crippled. They weren't able to carry swords or ride on horses. They were psychologically crippled that the thought of resisting the enemy wouldn't cross their minds. This made it easy for the enemies. The enemy found open doors and stretched out necks awaiting to be beheaded. The main point of all this is that when the dark era reached its darkest, when many thought it was the judgment day and it's all over, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends the ummah, those who remind them of their duties and those who take charge. Among them, as I said, is Sayf al-Din Qutuz. He tried to unite the ummah. But you know, among his biggest obstacles was the lack of izzah and lack of yaqeen in the hearts of the ummah during his time. He wanted a small, tiny victory so that he can resuscitate optimism into the hearts of the ummah, into the dead hearts of the ummah back then. The army of the enemy back then was referred to, like many of the armies today, the undefeatable army. So the Muslims were terrified. Sayf al-Din Qutuz sends beepers to Gaza. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect Gaza. And he sends with him a small portion of his army to trick and drag the enemy into a battle, while the major portion of the army was way back out of sight. That small unit was supposed to drag the enemy into a battle, and the enemy, of course, would be unprepared, thinking it's just a small group of people. And then the remaining Muslim army would come and rush them. It ended up that the small unit of Muslims defeated the small unit of the Tatar, and it was the initial victory that changed history by the will of Allah. The small ground victory was desperately needed to uplift and raise the spirit and confidence of the ummah psychologically. That's how important this topic is. That battle blew the defeatist mentality out of the minds of the Muslims, and it led to the more famous battle of Ain Jalut, which was the beginning of the end for the Tatar. The crusaders entered the Muslim lands carrying their crosses and swords. They killed the Muslims under the crosses. They occupied the holy lands, the same lands that are occupied by the Zionists today, and for a much longer time frame than the Zionists occupy the holy lands today. The story of what happened to them is a series, and their crimes and massacres is another series. What happened to them was no different than what happened to the Tatar, and what will always happen to all the enemies of Islam and Muslims. Islam is a rock every oppressor and taghut will be crushed on by the will of Allah. The crusaders established a fort on every mountain and a garrison in every valley. وَظَنُّوا أَنَّهُمْ مَانِعَتُهُمْ حُصُونُهُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ. They thought their fortresses would defend them from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it was only a matter of time until the Muslims gathered themselves, and the shouts of Allahu Akbar grew loud, shaking the mountains. Lives of children, women, and men may be lost. Towns may be leveled, but we are an ummah that quickly recovers. We gather the pieces. We quickly catch our breath. We wipe away our sorrows. We heal the wounds. And we set out from where we stopped from, raising the pure banner of Tawheed, moving forward, regaining our lands and our dignity and our pride. Muslims ended up fighting the crusaders and killing nearly 30,000 of them. And they captured approximately 30,000 more. There was so much crusaders killed that those who saw the dead invaders thought no one was left alive. And there were so many prisoners taken, those who saw the prisoners thought no one was killed in the battle. So many killed and so many prisoners. A Muslim peasant was seen dragging 30-some slaves tied with a rope from his tent. And he's taking them to the market to sell one or some of them in exchange for a dog. In exchange for a herding dog. A Muslim peasant was now selling the occupier as a slave. Some were selling the slaves that once occupied them in exchange for a pair of shoes. What I'm saying is not a fantasy or a fairy story. It's actually documented in history. And the same will happen to all those who harm Muslims, the ones who imprison and kill us and our children and our families. When we fully turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants, using the methods Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose. Democracy, alliance with the Rawafid, talk of nationalism, voting for Biden, or now abandon Biden. All that is means for failure. It's means for defeat and not for victory. When Muslims finally found the guided path, the crusaders who killed them and raped their women were now sold in the slave markets. Their value was the value of a dog or a pair of shoes. Not only did Muslims emerge out of that period victorious, liberating Palestine and the Muslim lands, but they kept pushing the enemy back and back out of Muslim lands into their lands. And they kept pushing them further back, all the way down to Vienna, within less than 350 years after they occupied our holy lands. The lesson is that our ummah may reel under blows, but we remain standing. Our ummah gets wounded, but never slaughtered. Our ummah may slumber, but it doesn't go unconscious. We may get sick and weak, but the ummah doesn't die. If the ummah was to die, it would have died when the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was surrounded in the cave, or when Suraqa radiallahu anhu was about to attack him, or in Badr, or in Al-Khandaq, or when most apostated after the death of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or during the fitna of Khalq al-Quran, or when the Tatar and the Maghul and the Crusaders and the Qaramita invaded Muslim lands. This ummah needs youth who will resuscitate and bring back to life our noble past. Youth who understand how victory is attained. How it was attained in Ain Jalut and in Hittin, and in other battles in our glorious past.
If making a suitable Islam for the West, for the Kafir West, is the solution, then why are they massacring the Muslims in Gaza and elsewhere after most of the Shiuch gave them the Islam that they wanted? Islam is beautiful the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed it. It's taught as it is, take it or leave it. Islam can never be stripped from jihad, the highest point of Islam, like the Jews of the Qibla and the liberals and modernists want. The West and the Kuffar want Muslims with no Islam. They want so-called Muslims with no Islam. The Kafir West and the Jews of the Qibla want an Islam with a severed tongue and paralyzed limbs. They want their adherents to promote an Islam with extracted tusks and pulled out fangs. If you teach the true Islam the way it's revealed by Allah, the Islam of honor and glory, the West will call you an extremist, and the Jews of the Qibla and the liberals will call you a Khariji. The West and the Jews of the Qibla and the Murji'a leaders, their Shiuch and followers, want Muslims to be massacred. A massacre after another, a genocide after another, and they want them to take it with a smile on their faces and an open heart. If they bomb our children and some of their blood accidentally splashes on the invaders, then those children should apologize. They want an Islam clipped of its wings and nails. Jihad to Islam is like the center pole of a tent. The center pole of a tent is the primary structural support for keeping the tent upright. They want an Islam with no center pole. Imagine a tent without a center pole in it. They want a tent flat on the floor so they can step all over it. Jihad is the hump and pillar and pinnacle of Islam. The da'wah bandits robbed the ummah from the honor and glory of the pinnacle of Islam. It's about time you ask your local imam in your community, whether it's the masjid of the modernists and liberals or the Jews of the Qibla who dominate most of the masajid in the West. Ask them why in the past 20 years you haven't heard an inspirational halaqa and series and khutab on the true unadulterated meanings of jihad. The liberals and modernists are willing to bring politicians whose hands are dripping with the blood of Muslims around the pulpits, telling you to elect them, but would never be willing to bring someone to teach the pure tawheed. They'll bring various kuffar around the pulpits and mihrabs to engage in the kufr of interfaith, but would never sit with someone teaching the pure tawheed. Wala and bara, and what displeases the kuffar. There was once upon a time in our history when Muslims had oppressive rulers. They oppressed their own people, yes. But when a foreign kafir would attempt to harm a single Muslim or a woman or child, the armies would mobilize and it would be considered a declaration of war, and it would shake the Muslim rulers and unprecedented force would be used. We mentioned so many times the stories of Al-Hajjaj and Al-Mu'tasim and others who mobilized armies when a woman or a few women were transgressed on. And before that, and better than that, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who sent an army, not for a genocide that's quickly reaching 15,000 Muslim victims, but for a woman who was dishonored. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam himself led the army and ousted an entire Jewish tribe for a woman. Bani Qaynuqa were powerful. They weren't weak. They had weapons. They had fortresses and military tactics. But the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't take any of that into consideration when a single woman was transgressed on and dishonored. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't say, they're too strong, we can't face off with them. When jihad is under the pure banner of tawheed, and it's to protect Muslims and their lands and their lives and their honor, the result is وَكَانَ حَقًّا عَلَيْنَا نَصْرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. The result is وَمَا النَّصْرُ إِلَّا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. The result is إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ وَيُثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَكُمْ. In nearly all major battles with decisive victories for the Muslims were outnumbered, outpowered. Victory is not for whoever's powerful. Victory is not in the hands of the Soviets or the US or Iran or China. Victory is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah gives you victory, no one can defeat you. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lets you down, no one can help you. إن ينصركم الله فلا غالب لكم وإن يخذلكم فمن ذا الذي ينصركم من بعده. The rule on victory is very simple. Victory goes to whoever's atqa, to the one who fears Allah more. If there's no atqa, it goes to the aqwa. It goes to the one who's more powerful. It becomes power versus power. Sheikh Abdul Hamid Kishk used to say, and today we're not atqa nor aqwa. When I was 16 years old, I was going over a grammar book with Sheikh Abdul Majid al-Raymi rahimahullah ta'ala from Yemen. We got the examples for certain grammatical rules. And if I remember correctly, I think the chapter was on al-masdar. Some of the examples is daraba yadribu darban. Daraba yadribu darban. I think the other one was qataltuhu qatla. He paused. He said, look, subhanallah, even in the grammar books, they were pushing the meaning of izzah in the hearts of the ummah. They're pushing izzah in the hearts of the ummah through examples and grammatical rules. It's not the fiqh books of jihad or the seerah of jihad. Grammatical rules where they push izzah in the hearts of the ummah. When Muslims were merely threatened, the tone of honor in the glorious past was من هارون أمير المؤمنين إلى نقفور كلب الروم قد قرأت كتابك يا ابن الكافرة والجواب ما تراه لا ما تسمعه. From هارون الرشيد to نقفور, the leader of the believers, to نقفور, the Roman dog. I read your letter. He sent a letter. The leader of the Romans sent a letter to Harun threatening him. Harun said, I read your letter. And the answer will be what you see, not what you hear. For merely a threat. Not for a massacre and a genocide. 57 Muslim countries. 22 Arabic ones. Surrounded Palestine. Some literally a stone's throw away. Nearly a half a billion Arab soldiers surrounding the enemies with billions spent on them. And they can't mobilize to stop a genocide or nourish the thirsty, innocent throats of our children from the Nile that's owned by Muslims just a few kilometers away. What have their rulers done but protect the borders and interests of the enemies? Establish pure Sharia in Gaza today and watch 86 countries mobilize and invade it. Jihad is two types in the Quran and the Sunnah. Now, when we see a verse or a hadith, how do we know which jihad? Is it the jihad of the kuffar or is it the jihad of the nafs? Usually the context of the verse or hadith are very clear on what form of jihad it is. Sometimes a hadith may even mention both forms of jihad. It's clear in the context, and the ulama of the haqq explained each ayah and each hadith. Now, if jihad is mentioned broad and general, unrestricted to the jihad of the nafs or the jihad of the kuffar, then it means jihad of the kuffar. When it's mentioned broad in general without being restricted to a specific meaning, it means fighting for the sake of Allah. It means qital. Ibn Rushd summarized everything I just said in a one-liner. He said, فَكُلُّ مَنْ أَتْعَبَ نَفْسَهُ فِي ذَاتِ اللَّهِ فَقَدْ جَاهَدَ فِي سَبِيلِهِ. Everyone who exerts an effort for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done jihad. فَكُلُّ مَنْ أَتْعَبَ نَفْسَهُ فِي ذَاتِ اللَّهِ فَقَدْ جَاهَدَ فِي سَبِيلِهِ. إِلَّا أَنَّ الْجِهَادَ إِذَا أُطْلِقَ لَا يَقَعُ إِلَّا عَلَى مُجَاهَدَةِ الْكُفَّارِ بِالسَّيْفِ. إِلَّا أَنَّ الْجِهَادَ إِذَا أُطْلِقَ لا يقع إلا على مجاهدة الكفار بالسيف. Ibn Rushd said, when jihad is mentioned broad, general, unconditional, then it's fighting the kuffar with the sword. So the context will tell you what type of jihad it is. And the ulama explained it. If jihad is broad and general in any verse or any hadith, it's jihad of the kuffar physically. When you understand this, you understand that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders jihad, qital, which is war, and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered it, then it's holy. Ghazwa, the definition of ghazwa, means battles against the kuffar that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself led. He went on 28 of the ghazawat. That's holy war. So yes, there's holy war in Islam. It's jihad. This may be a surprise to many who grew up in the West, especially those who were born or grew up post 9/11, because of the growing number of the munafiqeen who are spreading the American Zionist Islam. And it has nothing to do with Islam. That version of Islam is an Islam that suits the enemies. It's a version of Islam where they've eliminated the term jihad from it or its proper definition. You have some zanadiqa telling the ummah that the verses of jihad only apply to the Sahaba. And others telling you that there's no holy war in Islam. Now with the current ongoing events that exposed all the Muslims in the West, especially the youth in the West, especially the youth in America, need to wake up. The current events are a wake-up call for Muslims to start normalizing mentioning jihad's proper meaning and putting it back into their vocabulary. Jihad must be a common, normal term on the tongues and on your social media and in the masajid and elsewhere. It's time to seek lessons on the rules and regulations of jihad from its chapters that are in every single reference book of fiqh. It's time to learn the glory and honor of jihad from the books of seerah. It's time the mothers nurse their infants with the love of jihad and the ambition of wanting to become a mujahideen, a shaheed. It's about time the youth brag about the teachings of jihad that are in the Quran and in the Sunnah and in the Seerah. Never be ashamed of teachings that are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever they are. Never compromise. Never compromise so the kuffar will think your religion is cute or so they'll like you or like Islam, because they'll never be pleased with you unless you join their faith. Muslims led the globe and they never cared nor gave any consideration into what the kuffar liked or hated.